Welcome to Porsche Centre East London for what I am absolutely certain is going to be a different kind of evening. When I say different, I mean brilliant. Last time I was on this stage, I was with six-time Le Mans winner, double world sports car champion Jackie Ickx. He was charming, articulate, urbane, smooth, handsome, cool, suited, suntanned, slick back haired, and basically kind of sexy, even if I say it myself. Tonight's guest is all of those things as well. Please raise the roof for Magnus Walker.
I've actually never been to Le Mans. I'm actually here for the East London Beer Convention.
Have a seat. Good to see you.
That's good to be here. Good to be here.
We've done something quite special tonight.
And I want a whole bunch of Porsche people in a room.
Yeah. You've got a big fan club.
Some of them came on the train.
Did they?
Yeah. Just don't matter how you get here, you just got to get here, right?
What? If you were a Porsche lover, why would you come on a train?
Well, that's what I asked. Several people came in an Audi, and somewhere here there's one guy that came in a Ferrari. Can that guy stand up, please? The Ferrari owner, there he is! That guy came in a Ferrari!
Is that the 550 parked right at the back? I beg your pardon.
They're just like Porsches, they all look the same, they're just not as good, really. But yeah, there's the Ferrari guy right there, so I wanted to point him out in a room of Porsche guys. But thank you very much for coming.
You've been outside already doing selfies and signatures, haven't you?
Well, I'm getting some beard grooming advice from the good-looking crowd here, yeah.
Mega. I want to take you back to 1977.
Okay.
And a certain car.
It's not that one hiding under there on the cover, is it?
Probably not.
No, okay.
1977, Earl's Court Motor Show.
Yeah.
You saw a particular car, and that started it for you, didn't it?
Yeah,
what was it? The
story's pretty familiar, but I'll tell it again in case people haven't heard. I fell in love with Porsche as a 10-year-old when my father took me to the London Earl's Court Motor Show in 1977. And there was just something about that white martini, white body, red and blue stripe down the side, three-color interior, red carpet. That was love at first sight for me. I think anyone growing up in the 70s and 80s probably shared that same enjoyment and excitement. You know, chances are you could have had a Porsche Turbo poster on your wall. Maybe you had a Ferrari 512 Boxster poster on your wall like that guy might have done over there. Or some of you may have had that Lamborghini Countach poster on the wall, but for me, it was Porsche. I actually wrote a letter to Porsche when I was 10 years old and said, hey, I want to design cars for you. And they actually wrote me a letter back and said, hey, appreciate the response, but call us when you're older. So that was a real memorable moment for me. That was when I fell in love with Porsche, and 40 years later, I'm more passionate than ever.
We have done something special, and I am slightly overwhelmed to tell you that the very car that you fell in love with, the Porsche press car, on the stand at the Earl's Court Motor Show in 1977, is under that sheet.
Well, that's quite a surprise, because I didn't know that was really under that sheet. I was just taking a guess, and it looked like a turbo. But I'm hearing that faint drum roll slowly beating. You guys hear that faint drum roll building up with anticipation for that moment when that black cover's going
to
be pulled off the car?
I had to wait until the cameraman got over there.
There's a cameraman?
There is, yeah.
Oh, I got another phone.
Nick and Ed.
Oh, Nick and Ed, yeah. I know Nick and Ed. Let's do it for Nick and Ed.
Big round of applause for Nick and Ed.
There we go, let's go. Oh, there we go. Now, where did you guys find that car?
Oh. That looks like the dangly bits on the dog, doesn't it?
It kind of does look a little bit like the dog's bollocks, is I think what you're trying to say. I think that's what he's trying to say.
I'm staff, I'm not allowed to swear. You can.
I'm the outlaw, so I'm allowed to do that, I think.
Magnus wants to buy it, Howard.
Well, I never said I wanted to buy it. There's a thing what I love to talk about, it's called OPP. It's what I call other people's Porsches. And generally, these are the very, very special cars that I'm not able to own or afford, but maybe I have the privilege of driving.
I want you to sit inside it, bring back some memories, because you probably never sat in the
one. No, I never did sit in the one. You mean to tell me it's locked though, right here? Okay, I was going to say, well, I'll keep the keys. But thank you very, very much. Thank you very much.
Howard, is it?
Hey, thank you for bringing it. How long have you had it?
About 12 years, but you're always a hero of ours, so thank you very much. Great story. We've all bought your books.
Well, I appreciate the support on many levels. How did you find the car?
I networked many years ago.
Yeah.
I've actually got the young black one.
Oh, you've got your book.
And they sit in the showroom, and it hasn't been used for 10 years.
Where's the showroom?
In Suffolk.
Okay.
Near Ipswich.
Maybe I need to plan a trip down to Suffolk.
Come and have a coffee.
Yeah, I've got to stay boosted.
And everybody's welcome.
Hey! Well, thank you very much. You keep selling them, but I'm going to hold on to them if you like.
Is it for sale? On the basis that everything's for sale.
How could it be for sale? Come on, it's priceless.
We can talk.
We can talk. We're talking right now. Well, stay boosted. Let's do it for that guy right there.
Thank you
very much. There he is. There's a man. Turbo Fever.
You'd quite like that in the Walker collection, wouldn't you?
Yeah, for sure. That's something that would look great in the garage. I actually do have a right-hand drive turbo though already, but there's always room for that really, really special.
I'm going to keep going on this because I'm on 10%.
10% is pretty good. What's that?
Yeah.
Get out and talk, that's what I say.
Right, let's get down to business. The book.
We just did. You're on 10%. It's not for sale. I got the keys.
Let's keep going with the business.
Okay. Stay boosted.
The book.
The book.
The book is mega and it's
got pictures in it for those that don't read like me.
It's had an amazing reception though, hasn't it?
People seem to like it. You know, I got to find time to read it, but I do know the story. No, I'm joking about that. Come on. Now, the book's, I mean, for me, its next chapter is like a trip down memory lane. It's actually been an emotional process for me, sort of going back throughout my life. This year, I'm 5 weeks away from turning 50. For those that don't know, I grew up in Sheffield, left Sheffield in 1986 as a 19-year-old and moved to America. It was a leap of faith, it was sex, drugs, rock and roll, and essentially it changed my life. In a sense, I'm more Americanized than I am English, but I have this tattoo that says made in Sheffield, England, and I'm English at heart. But for me, the book has been an emotional roller coaster. It's been a flashback, and it's actually been pretty exciting to go back and relive memories, and there's some sort of geeky high school photos there, and photos of me and my brother and my sister. I do want to take this time actually to give a big shout out to my mom, Linda Walker, who without her I wouldn't be here. So wherever you are, Lindy, let's stand on up.
Round of applause.
Round of applause for my mom. There she is, all the way at the back. So without my mom, Linda, and my dad, Nick, I wouldn't be here. So mom's featured in the book. And, essentially it's not so much a story about Porsche, it's my story about growing up in Sheffield and what my life has been about over the past 50 years.
Why did you escape from Sheffield? Why America?
Well, as a kid growing up, I was always into Americana. I watched American TV. There were influencers, Evel Knievel. I watched a lot of American car shows, Dukes of Hazzard, Chips, Rockford Files, Starsky and Hutch. And they all had these great cars. So there was a love affair of a lot of things Americana, and then American rock bands, Guns N' Roses. And hey, LA compared to Sheffield in the 80s just seemed possibly a better place to be.
But the Dukes and the Starsky and Hutch, they drove American rubbish, didn't they? There's no Porsches in any of that kind of cheesy Saturday afternoon American TV.
You know, I'll let you know a little secret. For me, there's no such thing as American rubbish. I have this tattoo here. Do you see that? You see what that one is right there? Do you know what it is?
I don't.
So I have a tattoo, it's a Super B. So for those that know, there's a saying that says Mopar or no car. And essentially, I'm a Porsche guy, but I'm a car guy. And so Dukes of Hazzard was that 70 Charger. You know, you look at Bullet, Steve McQueen, it's that 68 Mustang, it's the 69 Charger. I'd always loved Porsche, and I love Porsche to this day. But I think the common bond that sort of brings everyone together, true car guys, is the thrill of the car. It's more than a means that goes from A to B. It's all about the journey. And I think all true car guys share that same passion. It starts with a dream for whatever your car may be. You then chase that car down. I was talking to someone outside earlier on today that essentially bought his first Porsche, which is a 72S in bits, and he found a 27 RS motor, and he's putting that car together. So I think all true car guys speak the same language. You just pick your poison, your drug of choice. My drug of choice is and was Porsche, still is. But I like variety. You know, one time I owned all at the same time. And is that coupe? There we go. You know, one time I owned a GT350 Mustang fastback replica with a 351 Cleveland, Richmond 5-speed, Detroit locker, had a 67 type Jag, I had 269 Super Bs, 73 Lotus Europa. And my Ferrari friend there is going to love this story. I actually did once own a Ferrari. It was a 79 308 GTB, the poor man's Ferrari. And I also had a couple of Porsches all at the same time. And little by little, I got rid of everything that was not a Porsche, because all those cars kind of did one thing okay, but the Porsche did everything okay. It was the practical, everyday, you know, every man's supercar that was affordable. And you could get in and drive it. You could drive it to the racetrack, race around, drive it back, drive it fast on your favorite road. And I'd always say, you see a lot of high mileage Porsches, because they're built to be driven and people drive them. So yeah, I'm a Porsche guy, but I truly believe all car enthusiasts speak the same language, and ultimately it's the thrill of the drive. And I think we all speak Porsche. It doesn't matter whether you speak English, German, or like some of my friends from Mexico, you speak Spanish or Mexican. We can all share a connection with the car, and we're all here because ultimately Porsche is what we love. And I think I'm just happy to be part of the Porsche family, really.
Before we go into more detail about Porsche, I need to talk to you about pants. Because pants...
The two-legged kind or the three-legged kind?
Yeah, well, both if you want. But pants, well, pants is how it started for you. For people who don't know, could you elaborate?
Yeah, pants is how it started for me. I'd been in LA a couple of years, moved there by 89, 90. I was kind of running out of luck and money a little bit. Started selling secondhand clothing on the boardwalk in Venice, Venice Beach. And for those of you that have been or may not have been, Venice Beach back then, it was sort of like Camden Market. It had this whole cool hippie vibe and beatnik people making stuff and selling it on the boardwalk. And I started going to thrift stores and buying old vintage clothing, old Levi's and cowboy shirts and cowboy boots, and set up this little stall, kind of like a Portobello Road Covent Garden thing. And started customizing these Levi's by putting patches on them and started selling on the boardwalk. And that was, I guess, my first sort of foray into entrepreneurship and starting my own business. But I say to this day, 30 years later, there's a common thread that connects what I've done with the clothing, the property that I've developed, which got me into the film location business, and the Porsches that I've built for myself. They all have a sort of unique individual style that's just my representation of what I'm into, that I throw in a blend of what comes out is my own sort of interpretation of style. Like when it comes to the Porsche, I just do things maybe slightly different and just do them for myself.
So serious clothing took off in a big way, and you had celebrity clients. You moved into a big, big warehouse, you were living above. And then the movie rental, lucky break came, didn't it?
Yeah, the movie was a real leap of faith, but you know, I talk about connecting threads between what I did. It started with the clothing company that became successful enough where myself and my wife Karen were able to buy this building in downtown LA that was built in 1902 in an area that was slightly dodgy. People thought we were crazy when we did it. Well, in reality, it was the best thing we ever did because we accidentally fell into the film location business, and that allowed me to essentially have the means to have more Porsches than I really needed. And then almost a little over 5 years ago, I got this email from this Canadian guy called Timmy Moscovici, who had a little thread going on Pelican Parts. For those of you that know Pelican Parts, it's an online Porsche forum, and the thread was essentially called "Out of Porsche Collection Out of Control Hob." And it was me just sort of sharing what I was up to on this online blog. And Timmy had seen the blog, and being a filmmaker, he was a commercial film director and Porsche enthusiast. And he thought there was a little bit more to my story than met the eye at that point. I'd been in a couple of magazines, the Dutch Porsche magazine, RS Porsche was the first one, and then the English magazine Total 911 did an article on me, and they actually called the article Urban Outlaw. So we didn't even come up with the name. The urban environment where I lived and outlaw Porsches was what they tagged what I built. You can call them hot rods, you can call them sport purpose, streetable track cars, you can call them whatever you want. But to me, I had this vision that he thought there was more to my story, and he basically flew down on his frequent flyer miles from Toronto, and for me, I thought I'd never done any filming, even though we'd been in the film location business. I'd never filmed anything, but for me, it was like, how bad can this be? I'm gonna drive around and get some footage, and initially it was gonna be a 5-minute short YouTube documentary. 4 days later, I guess he had enough footage that it became a 32-minute short documentary film, which went on to win some film awards, London Rain Dance Film Festival, and various other things. And kind of put myself and Tamir on the map. Tamir went on to be a very successful commercial director, shooting commercials for Porsche and Audi and various other people. And I went on just to grow my beard a little bit longer and get access to people like this and travel the world. But I think people connected with the story, because the story, again, wasn't a Porsche-centric story. It's a story a little bit like the book. It's a story of passion and never giving up on your dream. And the way Tamir edited it, he made me look really, really good. He'd ask me a question, what does Porsche mean? And I'd ramble on for 20 minutes, and then he'd find the 30-second golden nuggets and pace it really smoothly throughout that film. And there's a couple of great moments in the film. One of my favorite ones was the driving sequence. I've been in a Michael Mann movie. I'm driving around downtown LA in that 68R car back there, the silver car. You know, and the music's going, and Tamir's voiceover says, what do you think Porsche would think of what you've done with those cars? And I remember the line, I said, you know what, I hope they'd be smiling. Long story short, 2 months after the film came out, remember that letter I got from Porsche in 1977 where I said I want to design cars for them? He said, call us when you're older. Well, 36 years later, they called me back in the form of a letter saying they'd seen the film Urban Outlaw and would love to invite me to take a tour of the museum and the factory. And that started my relationship with Porsche 5 years ago. And I've been fortunate enough to do probably a dozen events with Porsche. So it's enabled me to go all over the world. Last year I was in Sydney with Porsche Australia for their in-sport reunion. So it really kind of changed my life. I didn't change, but people started inviting me places, and I tend to say yes more than I say no. And I just try and make the most out of every moment and go with my instinct.
The book has a real sense of glass half full attitude. Your mantra is, what's the worst that can happen? Is that true?
Kind of like that glass there. I like to stay hydrated, and when it comes to driving Porsches, I like to stay lubricated. So I'm always kind of a glass half full type of guy, as opposed to a glass half empty. Because for me, it was always like, how bad can it be? Like going to LA, you spoke English and the sun shines. I mean, how bad is that really? I mean, changed my life, but I'm still chasing the next dream and still trying to stay motivated and obviously making the most of opportunities that come that make sense. You know, I've been fortunate enough to do stuff with some pretty cool brands such as Pirelli, helped them develop the Trofeo R tire for 15, 16, and 17 inch sizes. Believe it or not, Pirelli didn't make that tire for early air-cooled cars. They didn't think there was a market for a tire under 19 inch. But now you get a Trofeo R in sizes that fit all these cars that are here. I went on to do stuff with Mobil 1 and stuff with Hot Wheels and stuff with Momo. So, you know, it's always evolving, but for me it happens organically because I'm kind of that lone wolf one-man army. I don't have a PR company that calls up Hot Wheels and say, I'd love to design cars for you. It actually happened the other way around. But these are just fun projects that I love to be involved in and fortunate enough to be connected with brands that are sort of Porsche affiliates. It's, you know, Mobil 1's in a new Porsche, you know, Pirelli tires are rolling on, you know, Porsche are rolling on new Pirelli tires. So for me, it's great to have an opportunity to work with these global brands in some sort of capacity and being what I call a friend of the family.
You've become a brand yourself, haven't you, with a cult following?
I guess. I mean, it wasn't planned that way. I've had long hair since I was 15. I've been into Porsche since I was 10. You know, I guess timing's everything. It's like when the film came out, it was right at when the 50th anniversary of the 9/11 was happening, 2013. So everyone was writing about the then 991 50th anniversary car. And I think, you know, I'm not your typical Porsche looking person, if there is such a thing. But, you know, I guess my story clicked with a lot of journalists and the story kept evolving. And little by little, you know, the story is unfolding into the next chapter, which is the book. But I just do things organically. There's no master plan. It's like people say, where do you want to be in 5 years? I don't know where I'm really going to be in 5 months. But for me, you know, I just like to do things that make me, you know, ultimately I'm happy doing, and ultimately it's slightly challenging, and I'm passionate about them. So the brand kind of happened organically as well. I mean, I've got an iPhone, you guys see me taking photos, I stick it on Instagram, and you either like it or you don't. But the great thing about Instagram is it's like the instant equalizer of, you put something out there and people respond and engage positively or negatively, everyone's got an opinion, but people are engaged. You know, here's a perfect example. I don't build customer cars, but occasionally I help my friends out. I have these guys called Sharpworks, they're English, they're out there in San Jose, they make these great exhausts, and they're like the classic case of when too much is never enough, these guys will take a 997 GT2 with 550 horsepower and do a 775 horsepower version of it. So they gave me a car, and they loaned me cars all the time. They said, do whatever you want with it, it's great. I said, oh, how about we add some color to it, because I thought it was kind of boring white. So here's a great equalizer, the GT2 I did with those guys, and I had the car for 6 months. It's either the best looking GT2 in the world or the worst looking GT2 in the world, depending on what side of the fence you're on. But for me, it's polarizing, and I'm just doing what I like to do, and like I say, you either enjoy it or you don't, but people tend to be engaged. Either that or they're just, you know, here for the beer convention rather than TV.
There must be a demand for people to tap into a bit of Magnus Walker. I mean, are you turning people away all the time who want you to?
Yeah, that happens all the time. I mean, I don't build customer cars. It's pretty simple. It's that 68R inspired car back there. If you said to me, yeah, I love that car, but I'd like it to be chocolate brown with a beige interior, all of a sudden that's not my car, it's your interpretation of my car. Then I have to make you happy with your expectations on time and deadline and quality. And there's plenty of people out there that build great, you know, customer bespoke cars. For me, that's when the hobby becomes a job. And when hobbies become jobs, they're not quite as fun, I don't think. So I turn that stuff down all the time. I mean, the last car that I actually built and sold, well, that one I sold to Liam in 2012, 5 years ago, and he allowed me to keep it a little bit, and it turned out in the Urban Outlaw form. More importantly, Liam and I became great friends. But the last other car that I built was the SDR, that 72T, which sold 4 years ago at Monterey, the Gooding Auction. So I could sell cars, it could become a business, I could probably do pretty well with it, but it's not really what I'm into, it's not what I'm passionate about. I'm not motivated to do that, so it's not something that I'm looking to do or interested in doing.
We'll talk for a little bit longer, ladies and gentlemen, then we'll have some questions from the floor. So think of something good to put to Magnus. Don't be scared, I think anything goes.
Big group of questions are welcome.
Yeah, and then we'll expect you to rush up and buy a book and get it signed. We think that'll probably take the longest.
You can do that, or you can hang out, have a beer, go kick tires, whatever you want to do. I mean, it's we're all here to speak Porsche, and I'm just happy you guys are here.
Let's talk about your collection. What did you start with? I think you got your first Porsche in the early 90s.
Yeah, the first Porsche I bought in 1992 at the age of 25. So 15 years after I fell in love with Porsche and wrote that letter, I acquired my first Porsche at the world's greatest Pomona swap meet. If anyone's ever been out to Southern California, the Pomona swap meet is awesome. It's everything from VWs to Chevys to parts to memorabilia. My first Porsche, which really represented a personal sense of achievement for me, having gone from this kid in Sheffield that never thought I'd own one. Ironically, when I was in Sheffield, I never even had a driver's license. I actually drove around without a license for about a year in the first car that I ever owned, which was a 1977 Toyota Corolla 2TC, which I bought for $200. Second car I owned was a 1988 Saab Turbo SVG, and the third car was that Porsche 911. That Porsche 911 was a 1974 standard model that had been converted to a steel wide-bodied slant nose. So the car was already modified. And slant nose is one of those cars you either love it or you hate it. For me, I loved it. So that was personal sense of achievement. That was the first Porsche I ever bought. The second one, it's a car that became 277, which started life as a 1971 911T, but it had a 27 CIS motor in it. So that was already modified. Within 6 months of owning that car, I'd sourced some real RS flares. They were welded on, got a ducktail, swapped bumpers, and hey, I had a car that looked like a 73 RS Carrera. So those were the two first Porsches that I've owned since, and I've probably owned over 60. The current collection, though, is really pretty focused. It's started out with everything from 64 through 73, the short wheelbase cars into the long wheelbase cars. And I owned a lot of those. I just started collecting stuff when it wasn't really desirable. At one time, I had five of the first 1,000 911s. I had number 174, 310, 365, 540, 862, and 1022. I don't even remember the VIN numbers. And then I caught a dose of what I call turbo fever. So for me, it was all about that white Martini turbo. But I had to start at the beginning. I like to collect everything in chronological order. So turbos were just 3 liter cars, small brakes, non-intercooled. I ended up finding 7 of them. And I narrowed it down to 5. I have 2 75s, one's a left-hand drive 75, and one's a right-hand drive 75. Now, to clarify that iconic legend we all love about Porsche, in 75 Porsche made 284 turbos. Only 17 of those were right-hand drive. I ended up finding a car in Australia. If you'd said to me I'd be shipping a car from Australia to LA, I would have said you were crazy, but I was on the quest for this 75 turbo and wasn't necessarily looking for a right-hand drive one, but one was in Sydney, Australia. I talked about Porsche being a language. I met these guys, came to visit me in LA from Auto House Hamilton in Sydney, independent Porsche dealer, great guys. So I called them up and said, hey, can you build this car for me? It was the only car I've ever actually ever done a PPI on. normally I buy it because it's, I have a motto, it's expect the worst and hope for the best, and having owned a lot of them, nothing's ever really too much of a surprise. So anyway, I bought this car, I've seen the Australia, shipped it to LA, it was God's red. The original colour was copper brown metallic. So Porsche made 17 of those cars. I think today there's probably, if we're lucky, 10 survived. Because, you know, they were stolen, went off the road backwards, parted out, or became race cars. And I think that copper brown metallic one's probably one of one. So that's a pretty rare car. I also have a 76 and a 77. So that covered early years of that, and then it just sort of expanded in the 911 range to own my goal. I haven't achieved it yet, but it's to own one of everything Porsche's ever made in the 911 range. But the big goal is one of everything Porsche's ever made in a sports car. So front engine, mid-engine, rear engine, both air and water cooled. So over the past couple of years, I've been acquiring transaxle cars. I ended up with three 924 turbos, one stock, one's a 924 Carrera GT that came out of Japan via Australia, and then one's this pretty cool Al Holbert wide body Le Mans GTR looking car with a wide body fiberglass Al Holbert kit on it. It was put on it in the 70s, or early 80s, I suppose. So, 924s, I've got a first generation Euro 5-speed sunroof delete, 1978 Oak Green Metallic 928. I'm chasing a 944 Turbo S, just in case someone's got one out there. And I'm also chasing a 968 Club Sport. So that's going to cover transaxle cars. I then stumbled into a couple of 914s that covered mid-engined, air-cooled. I've been borrowing my buddy Sharkworks GT4, which is a phenomenal car. Perhaps my favorite new Porsche is the Cayman GT4. So that sort of covered that. And then big picture 911 is one of every model. So currently I'm up to 996. I have a 2004 GT3. But the goal is one of everything, so that will include a 997 and also a 991. Because no two cars ever drive the same, and I like variety. And then my favorite thing, like my friend I just met over here, OPP, other people's Porsches. This is perhaps the favorite category. These are the cars that I'm not able to afford to own, but yet want to drive. I've been fortunate enough to meet some people who are super nice, and this is what's great about Porsche, and Porsche people, and Porsche passion. They've allowed me to drive several iconic cars that I never thought I'd drive, starting with 67 911R, Porsche only made 20 of those, and 1970 ST, and then I've been fortunate enough to drive one of every generation in Europe, the RS from 73, perhaps one of my favorites, the 3-liter 74, and then chronologically 64993. Perhaps one of my favorite RS cars is probably the 996 GT3 RS. That car is just such a raw chisel, track day weapon on the street. It's awesome. It's better than the 997, I think. And then also the exotic stuff, 959s, Carrera GTs, 918s, and all that sort of high dollar, fun, intimidating stuff. So that's Porsche collection and OPP.
Sports cars only though, so you're not going to be branching into KMs and Panameras anytime soon.
Yeah, I was pretty specific with sports cars, you know, that's sort of, you know, what I call the spirited driver, and Cayman's are great, and Cayman's are great, Panamera GTS is kind of a phenomenal car, but I don't need to own them. I'm just, you know, I've been driven them and fun, but I'm sticking to the sports cars.
We're among friends tonight. What's the worst Porsche you've driven or owned?
I don't think there is such a thing as a worst Porsche. No two ever drive the same, but they're all great. They're all memorable experiences. It's, I've talked to some guys that have 912s. I've restored a few 912s. I mean, I've learned a few things restoring 912s. It costs you the exact same amount of money to restore a 912 as it does a 73 RS Carrera. So you better bet you're in love with that 912 over your granddad's car, or there's some sentimental value to it. But, you know, 912s are fun cars. I drove one in Amsterdam 10 days ago. It's 3-gauge. I was buzzing when I got out of that car. I mean, I've had some cars that are dodgy where the floor's completely rotted out, but nothing's ever been miserable when it comes to Porsche.
Glass half full answer.
Got to be positive, right? Stay positive.
Apologies if I'm stealing anyone's question. One car. They all get shipped out. You keep one Porsche.
It's easy. It's 277. It's the second car I ever bought. Second Porsche I ever bought. It was actually the fourth car I ever owned. I've owned that car since 1999. Told you I bought it at the Pomona swap meet. Cost me $7,500. I mean, the sum of the parts of that car is nothing special. It didn't race Daytona, it didn't go to Le Mans, didn't race Sebring, hasn't raced anywhere other than all the tracks that I raced on, such as Willow Springs, Laguna Seca, Thunderhill, California Speedway, Las Vegas Motor Speedway, Phoenix Motor Speedway, VIR, these are all tracks in the States. But that car just, it's the car I'm most associated with. I describe it as my favorite pair of old jeans. It evolved over time. You know, as I got a better driver on the track, the car evolved. I never maxed out the limit of that car. You know, it ran a long time with a 2.4 motor, then it had a 2.5 motor, now it's got a twin plug 2.8 motor. So it gradually just built up, but it's still, by today's modern standards, antiquated. You know, it's running old Buckmeister sway bars, you know, it's got stiffer torsion bars, but it's still a pretty basic car, but it's got a lot of character and soul, patina, and it developed over time. You know, ultimately, I say this all the time, people come up to me, they want to tell me about, I want to show you my car that's got 800 miles, and I'm like, I got no interest in that 800 mile car. But you show me someone with a 356 with a million miles, and I'm super interested in that car. So to me, it's all about how many miles the car's covered in the stories, and ultimately that happens with the people. You know, a car with no miles in it, there's no story, no history. And without the people, we're all here in this room, I think we can all relate to this, we're all here because we love Porsche, and I think ultimately we like to drive Porsche. And so for me, the more miles that are on the car, the more memories, the more stories, the more memorable that car becomes. But for me, my car, if I got to keep one, it's 277, because it's the car that, I call it my flat foot car. I can keep my foot planted in that car pretty much the whole time, because it doesn't have gobs of horsepower. It's just got the right amount of horsepower, but it's got a lot of grip. It's on sticky Hoosiers. I mean, that's my car.
You're not just a collector and a sort of a modifier, if you like. You've done a lot of driving too, haven't you? A lot of track days. Did some instructing. Any plans to do more of that?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I took my aggressive street driving, meaning those days when I got a lot of speeding tickets. I joined the Porsche Owners Club in 2002, 15 years ago. Took what I call my aggressive street driving to the track, went through their time trial program, the club race program, got a club race license. And over the next 5-6 years, from 02 to 07, 08, I probably did at least 50 track days a year on the tracks that I just mentioned. And won some $20 plaques that meant a sense of achievement right there, but ultimately it was a camaraderie with the people. But 277, for example, I drove that from LA to Laguna Seca a dozen times and raced it and drove it back. And, I still have the car, the tracks are still there. I'm doing this thing with the Porsche Guard Latin America in Mexico City in August for the WEC race, and they're going to ship 277 down to Mexico, and I'm going to do some laps on, you know, the F1 track down there in Mexico City. So I still have a need for speed. I'm still out there doing what I call spirited drives. I'm not doing track days like I used to. I talk about the Porsche world being a big piece of pie and everyone can have a slice out of it. People want to take a car to Pebble Beach and have someone with white gloves and Q-tips judge it. That's great. You know, I'm on the next chapter where, you know, I'm doing a lot of traveling, so I'm not driving quite as much. But to me, my drives are always about quality, not quantity. You know, I live in LA. LA is a spectacular city for driving once you get out of it. I can be on this road called Angeles Crest Highway, 18 miles north of downtown LA, goes up to 8,000 feet. I was in snow there 2 years ago, May 15th in my 78 SC, in snow, in less than an hour from LA. So to me, tracks are a controlled environment, it's a safe environment, but I have 8/10 of that same fun on the road. That to me is what's great ultimately about the accessibility to world-class driving roads in LA. Driving around London to me is a complete nightmare because you're never doing more than 10, 12 miles an hour. So, you know, to me, drives are all about experiencing moments. No two drives are ever the same. You know, I set myself little challenges on these canyon runs, just like you would on the track, brake later, get on the gas earlier, trying to hit the apex. Come up with these little challenges. I got to get up to Creston Newman's Ranch quicker than I did it last night. So to me, I'm not doing track days like I did, but I'm still having spirited fun runs and challenging myself on the street.
Are you on first name terms with LAPD?
I'm quite friendly with the LAPD, yeah. But
it worked out who you are, and you come, I suppose it helps, doesn't it?
Well, yes and no. I have to tell a story. Last time I actually got pulled over, my Ferrari friend's actually going to love this story. What's your name, by the way?
Paul.
Paul. Let's hear it for Paul. Big hand for Paul. He's welcome, right? He's a car guy. So I'm going to deviate, but I do want to tell my story. And it's all about drives, and I've been fortunate enough to drive a lot of other people's cars, OPC. These are the non-Porsche cars. And some of it's pretty exotic, Bugatti Huayras and McLarens. And perhaps one of the most buzzed, like, stimulated drives that I've done that's non-Porsche, and I even put it in top five drives, is recently in Miami. I drove an F40, And that car was just like being in a bus, or it was intoxicated. It was almost up there with driving a Carrera GT. And the only reason I'm really telling you about this is I was doing these spirited runs over Key Biscayne Bridge in Miami. If anyone's been there, that's a bridge that Bad Boys flies under. And that car just rips. It sounds awesome. It's roar. It's like a Ferrari version of a 911R that's turbocharged on steroids. Anyway, long story short, I ended up getting pulled over by the Miami police. The car was on dealer plates. I had no paperwork. I'm on a California driver's license. It was looking like I might have been getting arrested and the car was getting impounded. Long story short, none of that happened, but that was the last time I got pulled over by the Miami police driving a Ferrari. So, fun story, fun times.
Brilliant. You've had a fun time in London, haven't you?
Yeah, fun time's not over. I mean, London's a great city. It's an inspiring city. For me, it's a spectacular walking city. I just said it's not a great driving city, but my last name's Walker and I like to get my steps in. I mean, last night, me and my mum were up Borough Market. That's one of my favourite places. The day before, I had to go to the Tate Modern Museum. I like to get inspired, so whenever I travel, I go to museums and look at all this wacky stuff that you don't understand. Somehow you walk out with a little bit of inspiration. First thing I did in London, I was staying in Shoreditch. I'm walking down Shoreditch High Street. This guy on a moped stops me. He's a fan, follows me on Instagram, power social media. He says, you're off to the bike show. I'm like, what bike show? Well, there's this company called Bike Shed Motorcycle Club that put on this epic bike show at Tobacco Waterfall in Wapping. And I went over to the bike show and spent 10 hours there because it was inspiring to me. I mean, from a design point of view, a car's a pretty big canvas, a bike's a small canvas. And these guys have got all this detail in it, finishes, you know, stuff's brass, copper, leather, wood, you know, dimple dye, mesh, and it's just color combos, pinstripe, gold leaf, all that stuff. So me, inspiration's everywhere. London's a super inspiring city from architecture. I love walking around, you see a 300-year-old church, and right next to it, it's this modern shroud building. It's in glass and it's cantilevered, and it's just, for me, it's an inspiring city to walk around, and I always end up leaving London really, really inspired in some way, and who knows, you know, where that's going to end up, but London's a great city for sure.
Fundamentally, you're an art lover, aren't you? Architecture, cars,
like
design,
style, you know,
clothing,
I think, yeah,
art, isn't it?
It's art, it's style, you know, I describe that as something, you know, it's like passion, you either have it or you don't, you know, it's kind of hard to develop a style, but inspiration's all around, so I would say, you know, just open your eyes and look up, always look around, and there's elements of inspiration everywhere, whether it's colouring, nature, or architecture, or some awesome cafe racer bike that was, you know, at a bike show that I saw, or, you know, just textures and things were all around, so yeah, I guess I'm a lover of art. It's funny, as a kid, my mum used to drag me around State of the Arms, like Chatsworth Park, and I didn't really have much interest in that, but 30 years later, you know, it's kind of a different story.
They had a World Championship Rally stage in Chatsworth Park.
That's true, yeah.
Cool. Right, let's get some questions.
Okay.
From your
someone's got a
adoring fans. Don't be shy.
Yeah, step right up, don't be shy.
Come on, must be something we haven't covered.
And there are no stupid questions. Haircut questions, be an advice. Hiya, how are you doing?
Hi. What you did to move to LA, that was really courageous. I just wondered if you had a return ticket and if you think the same thing could happen now to a young person doing the same thing.
I actually did have a return ticket, but I'll set the story up. I first went to LA in 1986 and I did come back to England for a brief period, and to me I was miserable in England. I went back in 87, 30 years ago. I did have a return ticket, but I never used it. But how I got to America was I worked on a summer camp with underprivileged kids, first time north of Detroit on Lake Michigan, second time was in New Jersey outside of Manhattan. You know, I still think to this day LA is the land of opportunity. It's obviously not quite as easy as it was 30 years ago. You know, I actually ended up being there illegally for quite a few years without a green card, but it didn't really matter to me. I didn't go back to England until right after 9/11, 2001, when my sister got married. So for me, I just kept moving forward, and it didn't really bother me that I was there illegally. It was just doing my own thing, and I was managing to survive. But I still think people can go to LA today and achieve whatever goals you want to achieve, for sure. Thanks for the question.
With the greatest respect to Sheffield, 1986 Sheffield didn't probably compare very favourably with LA.
Well, yes and no. I mean, growing up in Sheffield, it actually was great. There was a great music scene there. You know, I used to see all these bands that I loved, like Saxon and Judas Priest and Def Leppard and UFO and things like that. But LA really for me was the ultimate calling. I don't think if I'd stayed in Sheffield we'd be here today. I could say LA allowed me to sort of fly a little bit and play around and do things that opportunities weren't there in Sheffield, and the weather was a lot nicer. So okay, we got a question here on the front row. Hi, Magnus. Actually, we got a question towards the back row.
Okay.
What's your name, mate?
My name's Mark.
We got Mark. All right.
Yeah. Good. Thanks. I'm not sure how many cars you got, but I know you've got a few. What do you do about the maintenance? Do you do a lot of the stuff yourself? What about the servicing and stuff? Or do you have somebody? Do you have to employ somebody now if you've got that many cars?
I have a little team when I'm building stuff. It's a part-time ramshackle crew of three people. Phil Slate's the mechanic, and then Matt Bounds, my painter guy. He paints a lot of cars and a lot of bikes. And then I have a body guy called Frank Turner. So it depends what we're working on when this team comes in. I mean, right now I'm not currently working on a project. The simple stuff I do myself, or if I'm traveling, Phil does it. So that's kind of the story of the ramshackle outlaw little team of independent part-timers that come to me in downtown LA. Before that, I used to take my cars to places like TRE, and they charged me a lot of money to do stuff, and I wouldn't really learn much about it. And then when I stopped doing all those track days, probably 2008, 2009, that was when I started building cars for the first time, asking a lot of questions, making mistakes, trial and error, and that was essentially when I learned more and the quality of the builds went up and the cost went down. So to me, I sort of, even though it was a hobby, it was all done in-house under one roof in that building. So that's essentially the story there.
Right. It's always, I always feel certainly that, you know, if you, the more stuff you do to your own cars, the more in touch you feel with them, you feel a greater bond, don't you? Rather than just taking it to a garage and somebody else doing all the work, you get underneath it and you know, really get to know it.
Yeah, it's a great connection. I mean, it's a slippery slope. It's, you know, when other people were putting cars together for me, I'm like, you know, why is it taking me so long to put that bumper on? Well, then I realized you can slap that bumper on in like 15 minutes, but it doesn't necessarily line up where you've got that gap that's perfect. Sometimes you can spend all day making that bumper fit good, and ultimately it's the details, I believe, that separate the good cars from the great cars, and details take time to get done right. And hopefully you get them to fit right before you paint the car, because nothing ever seems to fit the same after you've painted it and try to put it back together without scratching it. So things like that. And for me, when I built my cars, they seem to fall into the same category of sport purpose, street or track cars. And I was trying to figure out what the end use is going to be. So, you know, I don't overbuild. I see a lot of people that overbuild cars and they go down the shopping list of all of these bank goodies, but yet they built this car that is maybe too aggressive for the street, and they're probably no faster in the car than they were before, but they've got bragging rights to the cars and coffee talking about all these mods that have done to the car. But ultimately, I think you need to figure out what the end use is and how you're gonna use it.
It's very subjective, isn't it?
I think so, yeah. I mean, half the cars that I own are not modified, so I mentioned that earlier on, some of the short wheelbase cars and the early turbos. But even those early turbos have been lowered and on bigger, wider rims.
Yeah, no, you could argue Porsches don't need modifying.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you talk about, you know, GT3 RS, you drive off the showroom floor and go to track days, and what do you need to modify with that? So there's modification and then there's personalization. I think the two are slightly different. But, you know, there's always people out there like my buddies at Sharpworks who are, you know, doing great exhaust and tuning, and everyone ultimately wants something slightly different, and that's why there's all these independent individual performance companies tailoring to those needs. And Porsche has its own department that does that. It's called Porsche Exclusive. And when dealer options are not enough, you go to Porsche Exclusive and get everything wrapped in leather that's custom dyed to match your handbag. So, you know, that's a great thing as well.
Okay, time for a couple more, I think, before we do. Because I'm right at
the front. Stripey shirt on the front row, then we'll get back to Lee Cooper 1908 right there. That's just his t-shirt, not his name.
I know you've been to the factory and you've been to the museum, but have you been to the secret vaults?
Yeah, I've been to the secret vault where all the fun stuff is. I've been to the archives, I've spent some time with Dieter Lamberger, I've been to Weissach. Weissach's great, they take your phone when you go in there, you can't take any photos. This year I got invited to Leipzig, I haven't been there, but I'm going to go to Leipzig. So yeah, I've been fortunate enough to kind of visit and experience quite a lot of Porsche has to offer. I visited the classic facility there and toured the factory and seen them build the motors and seen them drink beer during lunch, which I think is great. So yeah, it's a great place to be, and it's great for me to be part of the family in a small way. Thank you. Where am I looking?
Just over here.
Oh, there you go, stand up. Yeah, that wasn't the guy I was pointing to, but stand on up. Shout out. What's your name?
It's Jason.
Okay. You look a little bit like Mike Tyson for a minute.
Oh, gosh.
You probably hear that a lot, right?
I'll be interested to hear what you say about the 996 GT2. I've had one for 7 years.
About the what?
The 996 GT2. Absolutely loved the car, but it had such bad reviews. Just keen to hear what your take is on the car, because I'm learning it all the time. And I wouldn't know what to change it for. I've got other cars, 355s, that sort of stuff, but that's just the one car that I absolutely love.
First thing, I wish I owned a 996. I have quite a few buddies that own them. Second thing, I don't really read reviews, but I've driven a couple of my buddies' 996s. My buddy Helmut's got a black one with 16,000 miles on it, and pretty awesome car. And I think that's a car that you keep stock. I talk about my Shotworks buddies that modified that 997 and made it a 775 horsepower car. And yeah, it's silly fun, sort of, you know, spinning wheels at 130 miles an hour when you change gear, but it's almost too much power. I think the stock 996 and stock Form GT2 is just a car you put some sticky rubber on and have fun with it and don't worry about mileage. I mean, I was talking to someone the other day who had like 60,000 miles on his 996 GT2, and that was kind of high miles for a GT2 because most people don't really drive. So I say get some sticky rubber, leave it as is, and go have fun. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I'm close to 70,000 miles now.
There you go, awesome. You know, very impressive. Very impressive.
Thank you.
Right, we have got time for one more, because we've got endless books to sell and sign, haven't we?
I think we have a guy right here with his hand up.
We need some more mic passing.
It must be Tyler's Thursday, because that guy's not wearing a tie, but he does have a nice shirt on. It's casual, it's a casual crowd, it's all right.
As a 964 owner, I was just interested to, I know you've just built a 964, how do you find that as it's the first production 911 with coilovers and stuff, how did you find that driving that?
964 is a great topic. I mean, I don't know how it is in the UK, but 5 years ago in the States, nobody wanted a 964. I mean, you could buy them under 20 grand all day long. And then, you know, the 964 kind of became the darling last G-bodied, the classic shape that, you know, we all fell in love with in 64 and went all the way through 95, that 30-year period. Yeah, the 993, we know it's the last air cooled, but for me, the 993 is actually my least favorite 911. So I think 964, to answer your question, it's a great car. I mean, it's a topical car because today in a sea of people that backdate the 964 to make it look like something else or make a wide-bodied version of it, my goal with the 964, and I was late to the 964 party. I mean, I was offered 964 RSs 5-6 years ago when you could get for under 30 grand, and even I didn't really click with that car. So I was late to the 964 party, but like I say, the one I built was a bit of a hot rod former track car that had gone off the road backwards, a rear quarter with dinged out a 993 motor, and it had this Frankenstein monster cage, and it had the sunroof. But yeah, you're right, the 964 visually doesn't really look that much different from a 74G body or a SC or a 3.2, but it's got that distinct 964 bumper, side rocker, sharp fin, and rear bumper, but we all know underneath 85% new with coilovers. So, you know, the body structure is different in a lot of ways. It's got a 3.6 motor in the coilovers. It's my first coilover car. So what I chose to do with that car was, in a sea of backdates and wide-body conversions, try and keep 964 DNA. But in a sense, it's a combination of 356 inspiration, my build, and a combination of things that I love. Roof Yellow Bird, because I did rain under the lee. Sport Classic, because it's got that awesome channeled roof. And a little bit of GT3 RS, and then obviously I had to do things a little bit different, so that car is seamless. I mean, starting at the front, I filled in the license plate panel, got rid of that little sharp fin grille that always drops down, and then stretched the fenders slightly, and then I had Rod Emery, the 356 Outlaw guy, stamped those louvered fenders for me, and then I did that gas flap filler that came right through the fender, because I didn't want to do a center hood filler, because everyone had done that, and then I decided I was going to go sunroof delete, and a lot of people with 964s, you just build a lightweight RS, and stick a panel into a lightweight carpet and call it done. Well, I wanted to add my own personality and I had to one up that STR. But the heart and soul of that car is that 993 motor got punched out to a 3.8 RS spec, individual throttle bodies, KW coilover, that Brembo Club Race package, and sticky rubber, and weighs a scale at 2,560 pounds, which is quite a bit lighter than the factory lightweight RS race car. So it's got a killer power to weight ratio. It's got a limited slip in it. I actually kept stock gearing, line flywheel. It's just a hot rod. But what surprised a lot of people with that build is it's one color. It's a subdued slate gray color. And I think people might have expected that to be like my boy racer stripe, multicolored orange bumper, racing stripe thing, but there was so much detail in that car that I thought, you know what, I'll do something a little different. I've always loved slate grey, my 64 911 slate grey. I decided to paint it one colour because I think there's so much detail in that car that most people don't even notice the channel roof. It just goes straight to the louvered fenders. But one of my favourite things in that car is I deleted everything that was electric and then did a custom one-piece dash. But the greatest thing about it, and this sounds Porsche rap, I got rid of the electric windows and I took a manual window and crank out of a 65912, one of those parts cars, and would you believe it, it bolted right up to the same bolt pattern on the inner door skin. Now, 964s, they're electric windows, but here's what's great about Porsche. That glass drops straight in, so I talk about people saying, what do you like about Porsche? Well, everything's interchangeable, you can modify everything. If you want to put that 3.8 in a 64911, essentially it fits, just like those 912 glass did 25 years earlier. So the first 30 years, almost everything's engineered where it's interchangeable. And I was really kind of impressed by that, but it made me think, well, Porsche designed that thing right. The doors didn't change for the first 30 years. I mean, that car's been in production for 54 years now. I mean, the only other two cars that have been around as long, Corvette, that came out in 53. And then, you know, I'll talk a little bit about the Ford Mustang. I'm deviating from question here, but Ford Mustang came out the same year as 64 as the 911. And I often talk about Ford Mustang, I own one, I love them. The owners are really similar, even though the cars could be more different. You know, one's water cooled front engine, the other's rear air cooled, essentially. But the DNA is the same. The factory has a million different versions of the Ford Mustang today, from the EcoBoost to the GT350R, just like Porsche has a lot of different versions of the 911. But it's the people that are fanatical about both. When you think of Ford, you think of the Mustang. When you think of Porsche, you think of the 911. And a lot of people love to modify Mustangs just like people love to modify Porsches. So ultimately it comes back full circle to people just love cars. My drug of choice, my religion is the Porsche 911. To answer your question on the 964, it's a phenomenal car. I mean, it's kind of crazy how things turn around in a short period of time. So hopefully that's a long-winded answer to your question about the 964.
Thank you. Wow. Porsche passion. That's what it's all about, isn't it? I'm massively feeling it right now. Everybody feeling it? Everybody feeling the Porsche passion?
So you feel it or you smell it, or it's just a feeling?
Yeah. Yeah, I had it already.
Yeah, you have time for my Carrera GT story?
Yeah.
I'll make it short. I'll try to make it short.
You don't do short wings, no. Do you?
I'm down in North Carolina, Pinehurst Concord, with these guys, Ingrams, the guys that bought the STR, and they've got everything from the Gammon Coupe to the 918. And they said, hey, you want to go take a Carrera GT for a drive? Sure, why not? Before you know it, there's like 40 people around me watching you get into this Carrera GT. So all of a sudden, a bit humbling, all you ever hear about Carrera GT is journalists stalling the car, right? Well, that's going to be a little bit awkward. So I get it, it started up and started sweating a little bit. Down south, it's hot and muggy. And I just remember this one interview where this journalist said, it's pretty easy, just start it up and put it in gear and don't touch the accelerator and then you fall off the clutch and you're okay. So I was parked in this awkward spot. I actually had to reverse it out. I'm like, don't stall it. Just let my foot off the clutch. Just slowly came back out again. Breathed a sigh of relief. Got on the open road and then it was just intoxicating. That shifter, the sound. I mean, I never really got out of second gear because if you get anywhere close to the red line in second gear, you're going real quick in a Carrera GT. And that drive wasn't long enough, I'll leave it at that. That's my Carrera GT story. I can't afford one, but I've driven one and it goes under the OPP category of other people's Porsches. Any other questions?
I've noticed lots of people started going to the loo, which means we probably need to stop.
Either that or the really bored and fed up of, you know, listening to them talking about Porsche.
There's no danger there.
We don't necessarily know they're going to the toilet.
Ladies and gentlemen, form an orderly queue to buy a book if you haven't got one already. Magnus will be signing them between the two banners at the back. In the meantime, please, a huge thank you, round of applause. Magnus Walker.